Our next speaker and our last speaker before lunch, it is Pete Moore, who is from the Department of Political Science at Case Western Reserve University. Professor Moore is the Marcus A. Hanna Associate Professor in Politics at Case Western. He has held previous positions at Concordia University in Montreal, Dartmouth College, and the University of Miami in Coral Gables. His research focuses primarily on issues of political economy, state-society relations, and sub-state conflict in the Gulf and the Levant. His second book is entitled Beyond the Arab Spring, Authoritarianism and Democratization in the Arab World, published in 2012. In 2008-09, he was a senior Fulbright Fellow at Zayed University in Dubai, United Arab Emirates. Currently, he directs the Northeast Ohio Consortium for Middle East Studies, a collaborative initiative of several local universities. Please join me in welcoming Professor Pete Moore.
Thank you. What I'm going to do today is, I've watched some of the other talks, so I made some changes because I think this is a really unique opportunity, and this is also challenging. I have three boys all in high school, so I appreciate the challenges of teaching at a variety of levels. So I'm going to give you some conceptual things, some empirical data, but also I'm going to give you an argument, and the argument is about why what we call, and so this picture here is from Tunisia. This is one of my favorite pictures of the uprising. Arabs call what happened in 2011 the bread revolutions. So what I'm going to do is also give you an argument for why those happen and the role of inequality and a particular forms of inequality as well. This was a huge event, right? I can't understate how this event galvanized the region, how scholars and observers are still trying to explain it. So I'm certainly not going to give you the final explanation here. I'm a political scientist, so I tend to look at things that have a strong evidentiary base, but by no means is this the final word. And there's a lot of things out there that we about these uprisings that we still don't have answers for. And then I'm going to conclude with giving you where are we going forward in the aftermath of 2011. So let me take a step back first, because I think it's important to kind of frame what happened in 2011 in a larger historical period. First of all, what happened in 2011, even though I said it is surprising and that no one predicted this, it's not a bolt out of the blue. We've seen these types of mobilized and sustained protests in the Arab world before. And there's two good examples here. First, the first real hint of what we saw, if you remember Tahrir Square and all of the images on TV, we saw this before, first in 1977 in Egypt. They were also called, the bread riots then. They were spontaneous uprisings of Egyptians, mostly in the major cities, protesting the decline of, or the increase in prices as a result of the cutting of subsidies. These types of protests spread in the late 70s and early 80s to Morocco and Algeria. We saw similar uprisings in Jordan in the late 80s, and then really increasing in the 1990s and 2000s. We saw increased labor strikes, increased protests, but they were localized in a lot of countries. And then a second good example of what was a precursor was what we call the Palestinian Intifada in 87. This is when Palestinians in the Gaza Strip in a refugee camp called Rafah came together with no leadership, spontaneously and peacefully protested the Israeli occupation. This sort of kick-started that 1990s Oslo peace process. But this Palestinian Intifada was important because it was leaderless. It was not directed by a central leadership or a particular political party, and that's one of the strengths of what happened in 2011, and as I'll describe later on, it's also one of the problems of mobilization when you don't have centralized leadership. This was a historical turning point, so what happened in 2011 different than what happened before is this was sustained. It was mobilized and it was cross-cutting, meaning that not just laborers and students and intellectuals, but also Islamists, and particularly in Egypt, Jordan, and Yemen, women's groups took up leadership roles. So it was very, very important. And then Finally, I want to stress that whatever we call these things, whether they're rebellions or revolutions or uprisings, they're not over, right? While the media has stopped focusing on Tahrir Square, the protests, particularly protests that I'll describe centered on socioeconomic grievance, continue today. The discussion on Bosnia is a good example of how these things have metastasized internationally. You could look at Brazil. There's a lot of places in the world. Ferguson, right? The protesters in Ferguson were being tweeted by protesters in Gaza and in Jordan and in Egypt, telling them what to do when they get hit with tear gas. So this is I can't understate the importance of these events. What I want to do now is give you a little bit of an overview, just so we remember what happened before I actually get into the argument. So these protests, of course, they started in Tunisia. They spread across the Arab world. Yemen is the poorest Arab country. So you had all of the Arab countries. We can set aside the Gulf states. The Gulf states did have protests, but not like we saw in Tunisia and Egypt. It's important to understand how these things started, because this is where we don't have easy answers. Two young Arab men, one Khalid Said, an Egyptian, the other Mohamed Bouazizi in Tunisia. About a year and a half before the uprisings in Egypt, a young kid named Khalid Said, who was a blogger in the city of Alexandria, was arrested by police out of an internet cafe. That's where a lot of people access the internet in the developing world, through internet cafes. He was dragged out of the cafe and found several days later killed by the police, and a very famous Facebook page went up that had two pictures. It had a picture of Khalid Said in his high school picture, and then a picture of him in the morgue with his face brutalized. This galvanized young Egyptians. And this was the beginning of that thing you heard about, the Facebook revolution, the Twitter revolution, because the mobilization of Khalid Said, and every year anniversary of his death, will become one of the rallying cries in Egypt. Bit different, but similar. Younger man, Mohamed Bouazizi, not online, was protesting police brutality. He was not clear exactly what happened to him, but he was publicly embarrassed by the police when he brought his claims of unfair treatment. As a result, he protested by setting himself on fire in front of the police station where he was mistreated. This galvanized, this metastasized protests in Tunisia around his sacrifice spread throughout Tunisia. There are similar stories to the uprising in Syria, which we all know now is a brutal civil war, but started out as a protest, a peaceful protest against authoritarianism and economic inequality in Syria. So one of the things I wanted to get across is that these protests started with small acts that for a very long time were kept in the quiet. But yet now these individuals have become symbols for a much greater movement in the region. It's important to stress what Arabs were protesting, right? So the famous chant was, the people demand the end of the regime, right? Well, there were a lot of other protests, most of them socioeconomic in form. So the three I'm going to talk about are corruption, labor insecurity, and educational inequality. And one of the other speakers earlier today talked about dignity, and this is clearly about dignity. So when Arabs were chanting about dignity, they were also chanting about lack of educational opportunity, the problems of the job market, and rampant corruption. And just as an aside, these are both protesters from Egypt. So Egyptians are the funniest people in the world, especially people in Cairo, right? These are Egyptians have had to put up with a lot in the last 30 or 40 years. And so just to give you an idea, this young man down here holding that picture of the cow requires a little bit of explaining. You know this cheese, it comes in a circle, it's that French cheese, it's got the picture of the cow. Okay, so for decades, Egyptians have been making this sly joke that that cow looks a lot like Mubarak's face. So what he was doing is like Mubarak. So this is one of those, there's a really great political scientist here, Lisa Wadeen, who did an entire book, she's in the political science department, about how jokes under authoritarian regimes, when you share these jokes quietly amongst yourselves, right, it's a very strong form of sort of mobilization, and then it all bursts into the open Well, this is what happened with 2011. Egyptians now rolled out all of these great jokes they had about the government. And then this gentleman over on the right is a very typical Egyptian worker. It says, I'm an Egyptian worker. Where is all the money the company stole, you sons of bitches? Right? That's a very typical kind of Egyptian way of looking at the world. But it's important to understand that socioeconomic grievances, while they weren't the only protest in 2011 before and after, they did have a major core component. And then finally, I just wanted to set sort of where we are politically in terms of the outcomes. We've had leadership changes in Tunisia, Egypt, Yemen, and Libya, although Libya has to come with an asterisk because that was because of NATO intervention. But nevertheless, we've had historically unprecedented leadership changes. All three of those countries, Tunisia, Egypt, and Yemen, had the longest running presidents in the region. I would call what's happening in Saudi, Kuwait, Jordan, UAE, Palestine, Lebanon, and Algeria like simmering. It's a standoff, right? Violence has been deployed in these countries. The opposition is not as well unified, and it's a simmering situation. There's a violent standoff, or you might say civil war, Iraq, Bahrain, Syria, and Libya. So unfortunately, what started out in every one of these countries as nonviolent protest in some places has turned violent. So that's just sort of the framing so we all understand sort of what happened in 2011. Now I'm going to start giving you the argument. And what I want to introduce, and this kind of builds off some of the other earlier discussion, I'm going to give you what's called a political economy approach, okay? Political economy is a subfield, it's a concept, and I think the way to think about political economy is that classical model, which you heard a little bit about today, sort of the classical prediction for why you would get lower pay, or the classical understanding of inequality. This is the enemy of the classical approach. Why? Well, it's interdisciplinary, it's not just economists, it's critical and it's historical, but here's the primary thing that's a take home. The political and the economic are not separate. That's the classical view. The classical view sees an economy over here and a politics over here, and of course, when the political gets into the economic, bad things are supposed to happen. Rather, this historical approach from Ricardo, Smith, Marx, Ibn Khaldun is a famous Arab sociologist, historian from the 14th century. I'm going to show you one of his quotes. Carl Polanyi, more 20th century version. Another way to think about this is that earlier talk that talked about Paul Krugman saying that inequality is not the product of, say, technological change. It's about power. That's what he's talking about. That's what this approach is. The political and the economic are not separate. Some of our most important economic and political advances happened at the same time, right? It was unions, and it was recalcitrance, and it was labor mobilization. Those are political things that made profound economic changes in this country and elsewhere. Some of the issues that we can talk about, not just in the Middle East, but more broadly in the developing world that fall under this rubric, oil and politics, right? Do countries that export oil, are they less democratic, right? Or is it something else? Is it not oil? Labor and globalization, huge subfield that mines what has happened in terms of economic globalization to affect labor markets and how labor markets have responded to globalization. Or more broadly, we can talk about state and market. But what I want to talk about and what this argument is about revolt and grievance. What are the political economy sources of revolt and grievance in the broader Middle East, what I'll call the Arab world? Here's a couple of those quotes I wanted to share with you. 600 years apart, very similar. Ibn Khaldun had the great two-volume set in which he talked about essentially the history and politics of the Arab world. And then a 20th century version, Joseph Schumpeter, an Austrian economist, best known for what's called fiscal sociology. I wouldn't go so far as Schumpeter to boil everything down to fiscal history. But what I'm going to give you is a version of this argument that looks at the importance of fiscal politics as the underlying factor for the kinds of inequality that we'll see in the Arab world. All right, so this is data, right? This is what political scientists love to freak out about. I'll explain this a little bit. Okay, so on the axis moving up is the percentage of GDP, okay? So it's 10%, 20%, 30%, 40%. So that's the size of your economy. The bottom line is 1980 to 2011. One of the problems we have in a lot of places in the developing world, we don't have even data. So we don't have this data going back prior to 1980. But, and I won't go into it, but up until 1980, the Arab world, in terms of its economic development, does better than any of its other comparators in the developing world, better than East Asia, better than Eastern Europe, better than Sub-Saharan Africa in terms of income inequality. It's up until the 1970s we see quick gains in literacy, in educational attainment, all the kinds of social goods that are to come with socioeconomic development. This chart shows what begins to happen in 1980. Beginning in 1980, what we begin to see is a gradual, and in some cases, in the case of Egypt, rather rapid decline, over 50%, of total revenue going to the government. So what this means is this is representing all of the revenue, so taxes, fees, and, very importantly, external revenue. So for places like Egypt, Jordan, Tunisia, and Yemen, that revenue that's external is primarily coming through foreign aid. A little bit in Egypt and Yemen is oil, but it's foreign aid, U.S. military aid, loan forgiveness, okay? So this is the total revenue coming to these states. And that black trend line that's going down is showing you, is showing everyone, that Arab states have becoming more and more fiscally weak. This is what you call a latent crisis of the state. They have been, despite the fact their economies have expanded and there has been growth, these states are taking less and less money over time. And if you see the jump where Egypt is, a lot of the jumps that go up, right, so this spike right here, if you look at the time period post 1980-82, why do you think Egypt's revenue jumped so quickly in that period? Yeah? Right. Yeah, so in 1979, if you guys, so I'm from Georgia, I remember Jimmy Carter. Jimmy got a peace agreement between Egypt and Israel called the Camp David Accords. That spike line is the payoff for the peace treaty. That's what Egypt got. It got billions in U.S. foreign aid, military aid, and loan forgiveness. But keep in mind, even with all of this U.S. money, and it's mostly U.S. money that's going into these four strategic Arab countries, the trend line is down. Even though they're getting more foreign aid, their state as a whole is becoming more and more fiscally weak. Why is this important? Because what I'm going to show is that over this period, states and societies in the Arab world have attempted to cope with this shortfall. And that coping has led to severe or accentuated inequality in a number of ways. And I think the other way to think about this is that in the neoclassical tradition, poverty and inequality tends to be static. A good example of this is the World Bank. The World Bank ranks poverty in the world at a dollar and a quarter or a dollar a day. If you look by that, then the World Bank can then go, hey, poverty's getting better because more of the population is going on a dollar and a quarter a day than they were 10 years ago. The problem is poverty and inequality are relational. A dollar and a quarter is going to go a lot further in South Africa that has a robust, strong state than it's going to go in Egypt, right? Because what the public sector provides is that part of relational equality or inequality. All right, so here's sort of my argument about the coping. So over here, I've showed you the latent fiscal crisis. And I'm going to talk generally about these four countries, but I'll use some specific examples. How did they respond over the several decades? Number one, they tried to revise spending, and I'll look at that in a little bit of detail. They also tried to go after new revenue. Very typical, very rational. The problem is that we're getting inequality in a couple of different ways. Number one, I'm going to show you aspects of educational inequality that have taken hold, as well as income inequality. One of the big things that was the rallying cry in 2011 before and after is corruption. Corruption has changed in the Arab world in important ways. And then finally, labor insecurity, because these Arab states have adopted rather interesting ways of dealing with their unemployment and low wages problem. Okay, so the first way to think about this is educational inequality. The Arab world, again, up until about the early 80s, is a real success case in terms of literacy and putting kids in classrooms. For Egypt, Yemen, and Jordan, you see literacy rates jump like 20% in a decade. The number of kids in school in Jordan is approaching South Korean levels, right? I mean, so on what, I'm talking to you guys, it's kind of, this is stuff you live. It's called educational expansion or fire and forget. This is easy stuff to do once you have a high level of public investment in the 70s. Build the schools, push kids into schools, boom, you're going to get a literacy increase. And this, across the board in the Arab world, was deemed a huge success. But what happens in the 1980s, once those public budgets begin to tighten, and once the fiscal crisis begins to take hold, Arab states are still increasing their public spending on education, but the increase is not keeping up with the economy, and it's not keeping up with the number of students. And what you get is a lack of educational upgrading. So you can think quantitative, qualitative. And so to give you a little bit of detail on this, what begins to happen is that Arab states, to save money and to placate a politically important constituency, will begin to shift spending from elementary schools to secondary and tertiary, right? They begin to impoverish elementary education. And as you guys probably know, that's one of the most important areas, because inequality at the elementary level tends to compound itself as kids move higher up. How are they saving money? Because they start switching the spending, they're actually spending less. And what are they spending it on? You begin to see contract teachers. In the Arab world, there are a lot of temporary work contracts for teachers. Skills upgrading, almost non-existent. They emphasize cheap fixes like technological, putting computers in classrooms. Jordan is the poster child for this. You know, Bill Gates has been there, and they put computers in all of the classrooms. But of course, you know, these are tools. If they're not utilized, their effects are much less. Arab families have responded, right? And one of the ways they've responded is a massive increase over the last 20 years of hiring tutors. We only have anecdotal data on this, and only in Egypt we have this. But here are some of the realities in today's Egypt. 2/3 of all Egyptian school children receive private tutoring, right? 60% of Egyptian families spend on average 1/3 of their household income on such services. So Arab families recognize the importance of education. They recognize that their public sector has cut back and their school quality is going down, so they're having to spend more money to keep their kids competitive. Another thing that's happened as a cheap fix is privatization. And this is not privatization of the public sector. Rather, this has been the evolution over the last two decades of an expansion of private schools at the elementary, secondary levels in the Arab world that has begun to accentuate educational inequality in ways that it really never was before. So one of my favorite examples is in Jordan. The King of Jordan went to Deerfield Academy. You guys have heard of that thing in Massachusetts, right? He thinks Deerfield Academy should be the model for all education in the Arab world. So he created in Jordan this thing called King's Academy. King's Academy is a private school. You can see it on their website with a picture of the king. This is the new way of education. The tuition for King's Academy is 3 times the annual income of a Jordanian. Vast majorities of Arabs cannot access these private schools. And then as the final cherry on top, at the university level, that kind of private-public inequity is outrageous. Egypt spends, in the public sector at its higher education, $500 US per student, whereas the big private school, American University of Cairo, spends between $10,000 and $15,000 per student. So one of the effects of a coping of this financial decline has been to increase educational inequality. I would highlight this book. This is a really good book to use in the classroom, Khalid Khamisi's Taxi. It's a series of chapters of basically everything from hilarious to very sad stories of Egyptian cabbies, sort of the life through Egyptian cabbies before the uprising. And it gives you a really on-the-ground view of how things have changed in Egypt. A good comparator to this is a book written in the late 60s called War in the Land of Egypt by a guy named Yusuf Kaid, where he talks about similar inequality, but this is like 1960s, 1970s Egypt. Spending revisions. Just like education, up until the 1970s, Arab states did very well in investing publicly in their infrastructure, and particularly in public wages and the expansion of the public sector, right? Because as before, in Bosnia, public workers are a political strategy, right, to buy political support, but they're also a way of increasing equality very quickly, because you can hire a lot of private sector employees and you have them boost. So just like education, you see this beginning of a decline in the 1980s. What happens? Public wages stagnate, particularly pensions stagnate. The result of this for corruption is rather straightforward. If you pay public workers not much money, they're going to look elsewhere to make up for the difference. And so they make it up by petty corruption and by involvement in the gray market. But corruption has become much more overt in this period of economic and financial weakness. And so, to try to explain this, I've been going to the Middle East, Jordan, Palestine, Syria for more than 20 years. And there was corruption. King Hussein, very, very popular king here in the US, he was corrupt. Everybody knew this. Mubarak was corrupt. People knew this. What's changed is it's become a lot more public, right? So what's happened is, as Arab states have stopped investing in their cities' infrastructure, so cities like Amman, you know, triple in size by 1980. Cairo, which is this massive, you know, I love big cities like Cairo, man. This is really where life is. And that city doubled in population. So what you're seeing is, as the financial crisis hits and the need for upgrading infrastructure in the urban areas increases, these governments, they outsource it. And they outsource it to private actors. So what you get are things like this at the top. This is called Jordan Gate. They were planned as the two highest skyscrapers in the Levant. Project started, I think, in 2003 with some Gulf money. Around 2008, 2009, it stopped. And those two things, they're still like that. It's on public land. There's no taxes paid to it. None of the labor that worked on these buildings is Jordanian. But here's the beauty of it, or kind of the sad thing, is everybody can see this thing. Like, these are monuments to enclaves of high-end consumption that most Jordanians, and in this case down here, this is called Palm Garden. This was a huge development outside Cairo that the Mubarak family was deeply, deeply ensconced in. There were corruption trials. Same thing. If you're a regular Egyptian, you're not coming near this, nor are you going to go shopping there. And so what you have then is this outsourcing of infrastructure that creates enclaves or pockets of inequality in Arab cities. It's a lot more visible. And indeed, many of the protesters across the Arab world, they marched on things like this. They rallied at things like this. And they held up pictures showing this is where the money went and why can't we get access to this? All right, finally, I'm going to turn to the new revenue strategies. Okay, so not only did governments try to make up for this by cutting and revising spending, they also went looking for new money. And one of the things that all of these countries did, Yemen, Jordan, Palestine, Egypt, Tunisia, and Morocco, they exported their labor. Now, this started before the 1980s. This was something that had begun in the late 1960s, but it really begins to pick up in the 1980s. And what I mean by this is that at certain points in Egyptian and Jordanian history, and I'm talking like the last 10 years, up to or more than 20% of their entire labor force was employed outside their country. They actually, these states adopted policies, particularly labor policies, that pushed their best and their brightest to go work mostly in the Gulf, right? UAE, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia. The result of this is a twin problem. Number one, labor migration is not secure employment. I mean, no one has labor rights in the UAE, right? So if you're an Egyptian worker in the UAE, you get fired, you're gone. Right, if your job's over, your visa is over. And at home, what these strategies did was push labor into the gray area and make labor more insecure. Here's the logic for why states did this. Number one, it's a way of trying to take care of your unemployment problem, right? If you migrate your labor, you can begin to take the pressures off your domestic unemployment. But there's another reason that directly affects the financial crisis problem, which is that those workers that go overseas send money back, those are called remittances, right? And remittances can act like a coping mechanism when your state is running out of money. So if you're not spending more money on education, remittances money can help make up that difference. If your job is terrible and your wages have stagnated, your brother is sending money from the Emirates and you can make up for the difference. Now, this is World Bank unemployment rates. So again, there are problems with this. As mentioned before, it's hard to incorporate the gray sector in these estimates. But most people believe these estimates for the Arab world are low. But the result is that the Arab world has the highest rates of unemployment of any other part of the world and the highest rates of youth unemployment. These are the kinds of ingredients for socioeconomic grievance that took place in 2011. And then finally, this one's a little bit more difficult to grasp, but I think it's important to understand. Labor standards, so that's the axis over here, in the Arab world are the lowest, meaning those are stated labor standards. That's why the UAE and Saudi Arabia are at zero, because they have no labor standards. Labor flexibility is a measurement of how easy it is to hire and fire workers. Again, the Arab world has the highest levels of labor flexibility, but that makes sense, because if you want to export your labor, you want to make it easy to fire your domestic labor to get them to go overseas. So again, the search for new revenue here has helped metastasize and deepen labor insecurity at precisely the time you have these other financial problems hitting Arab families. And then finally, and I'll stop on this and move to a conclusion, Arab governments also tried to make up for this declining resources, declining finance by increasing taxation, but they increased it in a heavily regressive way, right? So direct taxation is income taxes. That's progressive. The more you earn, the more you pay. Regressive taxes are what we call, the most common ones would be value-added taxes, sales taxes, and that's what these Arab governments did, of course, with help from the United States and the IMF, which said, oh, you need to raise money quickly, put a sales tax on. Well, this is data from Jordan and Egypt. This shows you what's happened over these 20 years, and unfortunately, these are the only two countries that we have this data from. Direct taxes, those are income taxes, right? Total, and this is total percentage of total tax collection. So they're only, both these countries are earning, you know, less than 40% of their revenue from direct taxes. And look who they're taxing. They're not, this is individuals, these are mostly professionals, doctors, lawyers, engineers, who have escaped taxation. Employees are public sector. Financial firms, these aren't private sector banks, they're state banks. So the majority of their direct income is coming from other state entities. The majority of the total revenue, it's coming from sales tax. And sales tax is highly regressive because poor families have to pay more as a percentage of their income than do rich families do when it comes to this type of taxes. So if you add it all up, at the same time Arab families are having to deal with heightened inequality in terms of education, heightened corruption and lack of access, they're getting hit with daily increases in expenses that are coming from these sales taxes. One of the things that I do in my classroom to try to accentuate this is I assign students the websites of malls in Amman and Cairo, right? So, and there's easy to find. What are the high-end shopping malls in these cities? And then I assign students to like go, okay, you're gonna spend, do what you would do if you went to a mall, buy a cup of coffee, buy stuff, and then try to have them figure out what that expenditure is based on the prices that are posted, or they have to go find other stores with similar prices, and then run the per capita income in Jordan. And you can see that an average Jordanian in no way could go to these malls, or an average Egyptian. And I think it, you know, for at least my undergraduate students, you know, mall research is, that's their wheelhouse, man. That's something they can do real easy. All right, so here's, I'll conclude here. I know I went a little bit further than I thought I would. Famous, kind of a heterodox economist, Nicholas Kaldor, he saw this in 1963. How do you switch this situation without having a revolution? Well, I think the problem is that you do need a political revolution to fix this, because in this case, it's politics which determines the economic. The mutual constitution of the political and the economic is one of the important take-homes that I hope that you've been exposed to. The inequality as a source of revolt remains. I don't think the 2011 uprisings are over. Unfortunately, some of them have become violent, but it's not over. And then third, this argument that I've given you is about states and the importance of when states become weak and what happens as a result of that. And on that, I'll take your questions.
Thank you, Professor Moore. So we have a good amount of time for questions, about 25 minutes. So 20 to 25 minutes. So is there anybody who has a question? Well, I have a comment to make. I actually used War in the Land of Egypt as part of an outreach program that I did with Kankakee Community College. There's one Middle East class taught at Kankakee Community College, and I recommended that book, War in the Land of Egypt, and the students really seemed to take to it. And so it's worked in a post-secondary context that I don't think is so far away from some high school context, and I think that the book could be used in a lot of different sorts of classrooms. So
yeah,
it's a wonderful book.
It's nice because it's written, it's one of these books where each chapter is from the perspective of a different participant, right? So it's easy to assign each chapter. And then Khaled's book, Taxi, is the same way. Each chapter is a different vignette from a cabbie. And one of the nice things is you can do the reading, you can do the earlier reading and the later reading and compare and contrast sort of the problems of modern Egypt through the 20th century. And like I said, Egyptians have a wicked sense of humor, so you can get a lot of funny, and very dry, dark sense of humor.
The setting of War in the Land of Egypt is during the 1973 October War, also called the Yom Kippur War. There we go. First question.
Early in your presentation, when you talked about education, the changes they made to education, are they in line with, it sounded a lot like our changes to education. So are they ahead of us in that effort? And if so, is there research to show what happened? Was it favorable, or are there any positives in those changes? Or are they kind of in line with us at the same stage that we are at, so you can't yet tell? Like, we can tell, but a little bit we can't tell.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I think these are similarities of type, but differences in scope, right? So, I think you're right. There has been this general shift in these ways of, like, cheap fixes. The outcome, part of the problem, again, with this data is that there's not good benchmarks across countries. There's only a few Arab countries that participate in these international testing standards. But generally, there is some differentiation. Jordan is doing not so bad. It's getting closer and closer to the international standards. But it's taken so many years to get to that. But I think one of the areas that clearly shows that it's been a failure has been how Arab families have reacted by reaching outside the school system. I mean, there have been more and more, in the last several years, more and more in-depth studies, particularly in terms of how public sector teachers are actually the ones doing the tutoring, right? Because one of the things in the Arab world, they have, the way it works, if you're familiar with the European system, like in Germany, they have the thing called the Abitur, the Gymnasium, where early on they separate students. In the Arab world, they do that in 11th, 12th grade. It's called the Taljihi, and it's a big, big exam that's taken, and that's the exam to determine your routing into higher education. And so a lot of this private tutoring that I'm talking about is efforts to prepare for that exam. Because what's happening in the classroom is everything is being dropped out. You know, in other words, preparation for the Taljihi is falling to the wayside because they're trying to keep all the other balls in the air. And so another area we've seen And this is where the governments are a little sensitive about this data, and they don't want it to get out. And so I only really have anecdotal evidence for this. But the failure rates for the Taujihi have just skyrocketed. So you've also seen, again, my home state, you know, that cheating scandal, massive cheating scandals in the Arab world around the Taujihi. So this is, again, I mean, you know, faced with tough situations like this, people are going to, you know, gray market sounds nice is a way to go. And that's what's happening.
Just a second. And then we have another question on the far right side of the room.
Hello. I was struck at the beginning of your talk how you pointed to the fact that across the Arab world, what we have known, or what the United States media has dubbed the Arab Spring, is called the bread revolutions. And it really had me thinking about how in U.S. news media coverage, the story of the Arab Spring was really a political story. It was presented as people, especially young people, demanding political voice, demanding democracy, and the critique of inequality was downplayed. And I know in talking with Larissa earlier as well, she said, I hope you don't mind me mentioning this, but that some U.S. policy experts as well have...
Sorry about that. I'm listening.
Have trouble... grappling with the socioeconomic argument at the center of the Bosnian uprisings,
right,
and want to interpret it solely as this, you know, political democratic demands. And it speaks to, I think, how you nicely said a political economic approach makes the argument that the political and the economic need to be thought together. Although within U.S. news media or even policy analyses, it seems there's often this tendency to separate them. And maybe this blindness or unwillingness to confront the socioeconomic critique that's involved. And I was just hoping that you might be able to reflect on that situation, the blindness or unwillingness to grapple with inequality, and maybe recognize that what gets labeled autocracy in the Middle East has actually been fueled by deregulation, privatization, marketization, et cetera.
Right, yeah, that's a good point. And certainly vast simplifications in the Middle East is like bread and butter for Washington and the public discourse in the U.S. And I think that, you know, in terms of on the ground, and this is something scholars have known that, so you're right, the protests were framed as protests against authoritarianism, which most of these governments, whether they're monarchies or presidential systems, fall into that category. But one of the core elements or sort of foundations on which authoritarianism has been allowed to survive in the Arab world. So, you know, look around, how many absolute monarchies do we have in the world? Most of them are in the Middle East, right? Jordan, Morocco, outside the Gulf, and the rest in the Gulf. But one of the foundations on which they've been able to survive politically is by shifting resources to their allies, right? So this right here, this tax problem is eminently political. Jordan and Egypt, the regimes are not going to tax the people. They're not going to tax this, and they're not going to tax this. And the reason is political, because these are the bedrock support constituency for the regime. So that sort of, you know, political power was supported by economic policies that in the short term make political sense, but in the medium term, which is where we are now, economically they're highly damaging, and they've actually exacerbated inequality. But you're not gonna, unless you have that sort of Nicholas Kaldor revolution, unless you have a real political or social change, this type of financing will continue as long as some of that external money, right, that keeps Egypt bouncing up and down, or Jordan bouncing up and down, as long as that external money is there, primarily the U.S., you can keep this sort of floating house of cards going. And just one other thing I would say that, it's not difficult for, you know, if you look at public opinion or sort of anthropologists are good at this, much better than political scientists actually talking to real people about what's going on the ground. They don't see a difference between the political and the economic. So like when an Egyptian worker says, my dignity has been robbed because the companies have stolen the money, or my dignity has been robbed when the Mubarak government looked to the Israelis and the Americans and said, yeah, bomb the hell out of Gaza. I think it's fine. Go ahead and do that. That was lack of dignity, right? Egyptians didn't want that to happen, or Jordanians didn't want that to happen. When their government does it nonetheless, people see these things as quite similar. They're forms of inequality, could be political, could be economic, but I don't think that people really pull them apart a lot.
Hi, it seems like there's quite a few parallels between kind of what's going on, obviously, in the Middle East with what we were talking about in Bosnia with the collapse of the socialist state. And I mean, so to what extent do you trace the financial crisis to the end of the Cold War, when both Russia and the United States were kind of propping up politically and economically a lot of these regimes, and withdrawal maybe of some of those funds and that support? And I guess finally, do you feel like, you know, I guess the United States was very short-sighted in kind of the expectations of what the fall of the Soviet Union would mean for these economies and regimes kind of, I guess, in Europe and the Middle East in particular?
Okay, yeah. So the origins of this, which I haven't really talked a lot about. Part of it is, you know, it's this difficulty of trying to pull apart correlation and causation. So this looks like it correlates with the beginning of the end of the Cold War. But if we're talking about the Arab world specifically, there's only a couple of states, Syria, Old South Yemen, and then Iraq for a certain period of time, but that wasn't important, that were highly dependent on the Soviet side for money. Everybody else has been an American client state really since the 50s or 60s. What really comes in, or where I normally get a question about the origins question, is 1980 marks the beginning or the dawn of the neoliberal era. This is the period of time when the IMF and the World Bank, you know, coalesce around the Washington Consensus, demand budget cuts. They actually, I mean, one could argue that this is exactly what neoliberal policies wanted, which is sort of an emptying out of the state, cutting your public budgets and things like that. I think that plays partly a role, but the other part that I want to suggest is that these regimes that we call, you know, authoritarian, were built on agreements, or built on sort of a social compact between, in most cases, sort of an urban merchant elite, and then a rural, in the case of Jordan, sort of small rural landowners, and in the case of Egypt and Iraq and Syria, big landowners, and that sort of coalition is one in which you would expect this type of decline, where you expect the money to go into either rent seeking or be captured by a small sort of political elite, and the larger parts of the population that were sort of kept above water through either subsidies or public infrastructure spending, you slowly kind of scratch that away and hope that you can manipulate the situation so that they don't get together and mobilize. So that's kind of a long answer for I don't think it traces directly to the Cold War, per se. I mean, if you really want to, and it's the last 11 years of decline, I think, have been accentuated by the war on terrorism, because what the Americans have done has generated and pushed, particularly for Egypt, Jordan, Tunisia, and Yemen, most of the money that we're giving them comes in security, right? And in a sense, security is fungible, right? You get money here, you don't have to spend it there. But what it's also done is it's built inside these countries a very strong cohesive security apparatus that's great for going after like bad guys on the borders, but it's sort of one of those dual use technologies. You can also deploy it against your political opposition. And that's what's increased a lot in the last 11, 12 years.
Just to pick up on that military spending piece, I'm surprised, and maybe it's the skewed view I get from the US media, that people in Egypt in particular weren't more angry against the United States. There wasn't more anti-American sentiment being heard. And it seems that the economy is so swayed by that aid. It's not, you know, it's not smart aid. It's not helping to develop the economy. It's keeping the military very firmly in control of the economy in Egypt in particular. I'm just so surprised that it wasn't more of an outcry against that, and how the U.S. kind of stood back so long before declaring itself on the side of the protesters. And now, you know, that aid has been restored to the Sisi government now that they're back in power, and it's sort of like Mubarak's back, and, you know, we can get back to normal life again.
Okay, yeah. And actually, just today, the U.S. announced that it was resuming military aid to Bahrain, which is really, even though it's a small country, the oppression there has been grievous. I think the I would say critical of U.S. foreign policy. I mean, some of the things that Egyptians say are anti-American, I think are very pro-American, but, you know, it just depends on how we deploy that term. They've been critical of the U.S. government for a long time. If you put the Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty or the Jordanian-Israeli peace treaty up for a vote, it wouldn't survive, right? It'd have to be revised, basically, is the standard. And that deep-seated sort of suspicion of the U.S., not trusting what the U.S. is doing, that was embedded long before the protests got going. So where you saw it, where it became accentuated, was when the Obama administration really was dragging its feet on Mubarak. When Hillary Clinton came out in her famous statement and says, nope, everything's hunky-dory, Hosni's a great guy, we're fine with him. You know, that, I think there were inflection points where it came that way. But also, and I'll just share this with some activists that I've met from Bahrain. And Bahrain's this small island, it's only 500,000 people. They were very cautious because the U.S. Fifth Fleet is based in Manama, the capital. That's where we do all our naval stuff in the Gulf. They had to be very careful about this, right? Because they wanted this protest to be about Bahrainis demanding equality and access. But one of the strategies they tried to come up with was most of the tear gas that's used on Arabs is made in my home state of Ohio, where I live now, unfortunately. Unfortunately, they make this stuff in Ohio. And so Bahraini activists had collected all of the empty canisters, and they had a plan to march peacefully to the gates of the U.S. naval facility and return the equipment. Pretty cute, huh? Well, Bahraini forces knew this, and they stopped them before they could get close. So they were aware, but at the same time, I think the idea was, you know, to focus on the sort of issues there locally. And this strong demand for a change in the regime was in many ways anti-American or critical of the U.S. because every one of these regimes that was demand, with the exception of the Assad regime in Syria, were pro-American regimes. Muammar Gaddafi, we welcomed him back in. London School of Economics took money from the guy. Mubarak, Ben Ali, Abdesaleh, these were all, go back 2 years before 2011, stalwart, doing reforming, fighting the good fight. So in a way, it was very critical of the U.S. to say, we demand that this regime step down.
Since you were talking about the Egyptian Revolution, you think, looking at the aftermath of the Egyptian Revolution, you think more countries in the Middle East are interested in like doing away with the current political systems that they have, like the authoritarian governments like in Jordan and Saudi Arabia, or are they, after seeing that, are they more interested in working within the system to deal with inequality rather than just to start from scratch and be more representative?
Yeah, that's a good point. So where opposition stands now, it's tough. So in Egypt, for instance, very difficult, right? The Committee on Protection of Journalists have come out with a report. It's the most dangerous place in the world now for journalists in Egypt. So in some cases, just outright repression has pushed activists off the streets. In other cases, I think what you were hinting at is very strong, which is that the incumbent regimes, in a way, the new military government in Egypt, the monarchy in Jordan, they're in a bizarre way kind of happy for the civil war in Syria. They're sort of happy with the insecurity in Libya because, and this was most evident in Jordan, actually politicians were telling their protesters in Jordan, oh, you think you're going to get a Tunisian transition? You're not getting that. You're going to get Syria. You're going to get Libya, right? And so many people are, and opposition groups that are still protesting, but in small numbers, recognize that it's harder to get that mobilized, cross-cutting alliance because of people are rightfully fearful, right? I mean, the metastasizing of these civil conflicts now is at a stage where, you know, just the other day, Jordan is talking about creating a buffer zone in Syria and things like this. So I think I don't think it's a question of a choice between working in the system or going outside the system, because of the decades of this, there's not much that can be done except on the margins. And so where now protesters are focused, they're focused on specific issues. So in Jordan, it's a desire not to have a gas agreement with Israel. So the same people that were protesting are trying to do that. In Egypt, they're just trying to survive. In the other ones, Syria, Iraq, obviously a war's going on. And in the Gulf states have deployed both money, trying to buy people off, but they've also deployed rather strict security responses. With the exception of Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, the UAE, the Qataris have all used security services in ways they had never used it historically. And so I think that, you know, that fear of having more instability is keeping people from sticking their heads up above the ramparts.
One last question, or we could stop there.
So teaching 15-year-olds about the Middle East, it's like, oh, which conflict are we going to talk about next, Ms. McKee? And it's constantly this endless dialogue. Can you share a little bit about future predictions of potentially what may happen 10, 15 years down the road with many of the various topics that you shared today?
Yeah. So here's a good disciplinary thing. I think one of the interesting things of this is you guys have gotten people from different disciplines. One of the terrible things my discipline loves to do is predict. Right, it's sort of like we have to predict. So, just my caveat is, I think I don't like that. However, you asked me the question, so I'll. I mean, this is it. It's not over. I mean, I think that we're going to see more unrest as these governments become progressively more and more as they weaken. The problem was the question over here, which is how is that going to express itself at the social level? How do people react? And I think, unfortunately, on the one hand, what 2011 did is it brought, those young people that sacrificed, I think they did win, because something has been broken in the Arab world. A line has been crossed whereby now we can have mobilized and an example of mobilized peaceful protests that can actually affect change. So that's the good thing. But clearly the other half of it is, as I mentioned before, is that because these protest movements and opposition did not have a strong leadership, in the early going that's great, because the old way of dealing with these types of unrests and political opposition is just to chop the head off, right? But if you have no leader to chop the head off in the short term, you saw how Mubarak, if you guys can remember his silly speeches. I mean, this guy and Abdel Saleh and the leader of Tunisia, it's literally like they were not on the same planet, right? But part of that was because they were like, wait, where's the head that I chop off? But once we get past that, not having a centralized leadership, the ability for leftists and Islamists to only get together on rather strategic issues but not broad-based is really hampering these movements. So on the one hand, I think the problems are still there, and the stresses on a declining middle class and particularly increases in poverty are going to continue. But on the political side, you're not seeing the kinds of dynamics that would allow for reemergence of a mobilized opposition movement. Now, there is mobilized opposition. Unfortunately, it tends to be radical, and it tends to be more willing to, you know, use violence. And so the air has been sucked out of the room for most of the activists. They're the ones that are left that, you know, don't want to use violence, don't have many options. So that's just a roundabout way to think. I think many of these same things are going to continue. If the United States and these governments continue to securitize the problem, you know, to contain the problem, I think that's going to make the situation much, much worse. And so the next shoe to fall would be the spread of the conflict in Syria and Iraq to Jordan, to Lebanon, and or to Turkey. And I think that's what a lot of people are fearful of. But let me just say one last thing. I agree. Too many of our students come into class, and it's all about conflict, and it's all about what the media says. And one of the things I try to get across, either through like these books or trying to the like Syrian and Egyptian jokes, is you know to try to create a commitment. So you know, for my students that want to go study Arabic or go study another part of the world, it's not even if it's the Arab world, if it's somewhere, you know, to kind of, you know, craft that commitment. It could be through language, it could be through literature, it could be through conflict, right? but most of the region is not, I mean, Cairo is a safer city than this place right now. Oh, I'm sorry, Cleveland, if I was pointing to Cleveland, because we have a higher crime rate. Yes?
I'm sorry. Yeah, I was wondering if you can see or do you hear about a return of people to those areas? I work with a lot of cab drivers and their kids.
Yeah.
The first time a lot of families are actually going back home just to visit. They feel it's safe enough, or they have the economic means now to go visit. But I'm wondering how that would contribute to some type of leadership in the opposition. Do you see educated, established people starting to return?
Yeah. Yeah, they do, and there is much more of a transnational linkage. The problem is the governments know this as well, right? And because you know the main routing is through airports, it makes it easy to keep security there, and they're always turning people away. The UAE has turned away, not even just Arabs, turned away just researchers from NYU. It's happened in a number of countries. And the other problem is that it's a version of brain drain, right? So these people leave, and then this whole thing becomes self-fulfilling. Like, okay, why would I want to go back to Egypt and pay my taxes? If I know the state's corrupt and they've screwed up for decades, why am I going to pay my taxes? You know, the goal should be, if, you know, rational, whatever, get out. And I think that's unfortunately what's happened. And then the other side of your question is the refugee problem, which I thought that's what you were talking about, which the refugee problem from Syria and Iraq is, the UN says it's the biggest one now ever. It surpasses the Palestinian refugee flows in 48. The problem with those refugees is they're not going back. The Iraqis go back and forth. Those poor Syrians pushing 1 million in Jordan and a couple million in Turkey, they're not going back. And the next tough decision for these governments, although it's not really their decision so much as the international community, is what do? You can't keep them in camps, right? Or can you? So I think that's a real front burner problem for these societies and for the governments, particularly the Jordanian government that wants to push these refugees out of their borders.
Okay, thank you very much.